What's up, Meta Nerds? This video is all about the key material to creating cloaking devices in the Star Wars galaxy. The Republic stealth ship and Maul's scimitar weren't the only ships with cloaking devices. We don't see a lot of them on screen, but the technology wasn't as rare as you might think. They certainly weren't cheap or ubiquitous, but since the time of the Old Republic, individuals with enough credits could get a cloaking device installed, and then in the modern era, you got stuff like the Rogue Shadow, TIE Phantoms, and even the Vengeance-class frigate vanishing right before your eyes. That last one is really important to notice, as the Vengeance class was commissioned by the criminal empire the Zan Consortium. Technically, he stole these plans from the first Death Star's wreckage, so actually designing one may have still needed military-level research and development, but the point is, as long as you have enough credits, you could get enough Stygium crystals to cloak a small fleet. And keep in mind, this was during the time of the Empire, which placed the galaxy under tighter control than perhaps any previous era, and was an empire that at that point had already suffered a major loss, and was clamping down on any materials that could be used by the Rebellion. And really, in the time before 22 BBY, there were no regulations on these crystals, but with the outbreak of the Clone Wars, one of the Republic's greatest fears were cloaked CIS starships. The Republic kept their stealth ship highly classified, and even had Sinar design systems disbanded after rumors started to surface of a cloaked armed Star Courier. But I assume that these engineers were not punished, merely moved over to Republic Sinar systems, working for the Republic to produce their military vehicles. A cryptic statement during the Space Battle of Christophsis was that Admiral Trench had fought other cloak ships before, but it was never anything the size of the prototype stealth ship. But that ship was no tiny starfighter, it was nearly 100 meters long, a third of the size of the Arquidens, so that makes me think that Trench was fighting Acclimators and maybe even Venators with cloaking technology. I tried looking everywhere on the Holonet for more information on these, but as far as I know, there are no further details on these larger Republic stealth ships. Throughout the war, any mining companies trying to sell Stygium crystals were severely punished, and under certain circumstances, would be considered traitors. The Republic had to crack down on the main source of Stygium crystals in the galaxy, the wild space planet of Aiden 2. Its location made it difficult to keep these crystals out of CIS hands, but once the Empire took over, they came up with a creative solution. Instead of keeping up a complete blockade over this otherwise useless planet indefinitely, why not just take all of its Stygium crystals and transport it to an Imperial research facility? Grand Admiral Marty Obatch decided he could do just that, with the help of the Tarkin superweapon. It was named that because the Empire was just recovering from the Grand Moff's death aboard the first Death Star, and perhaps a nod to Tarkin's cloaked personal corvette, the Carrion Spike. Using a variant of the Death Star superlaser, the Tarkin was able to blow the planet apart, allowing the innards of this world to be completely scooped up by Imperial mining droids. The crystals were then packed onto fleets of cargo ships, and taken to experimental research centers that would eventually produce the TIE Phantom. But interestingly, there was a lesser-known site on the nearby planet of Maramir that was also known for these crystals. The watery world was actually used as a Stygium depot by the CIS, housing a confusingly small number of crystals that they were able to amass. It's unknown why they weren't able to develop a cloaked capital ship of their own, but perhaps it fits the CIS's MO to avoid expensive units and just pump out tons of cheap and powerful assets. This world also had a natural wonder called the Invisible Island, which was considered a bit of a myth, supposedly having so many Stygium crystals on it that it completely concealed a small landmass. This was the site of a battle between Sol Sixa and the pirate Nim in 24 BBY, the former having a ship with cloaking technology. Sixa got this from the Nymoidian Lord Toad's pleasure craft named the Siren, and by using it to launch raids on the CIS, he sparked tales of ghost marauders on Maramir that could appear out of thin air. Now there is also one more very strange use of Stygian crystals. Supposedly, in their most pure form, it could be used as a lightsaber crystal, allowing the Jedi to access its cloaking abilities by channeling the Force through it. So that's it for the history of Stygium crystals, but you definitely want to hear these cool facts and behind-the-scenes stuff. The Tarkin superweapon was first mentioned in the comic Star Wars 51 back in 1981, and the planet Aiden 2 is first named in the Episode 1 cross-section, along with a naming of the Stygian crystals. Additional information is provided in the new Essential Chronology and Essential Guide to Warfare. And the Stygium crystals are brought back into canon via the Tarkin novel. That book also canonized an alternative cloaking crystal known as Hybridium. In Legends, this material was considered for the TIE Phantom project, but there was a problem that was called double blindness. You couldn't see the ship, but the personnel inside of the ship also couldn't see out or detect anything outside of the cloaking bubble. As for that whole Maramir section, that was found in the Starfighter comic series, and these crystals also play an important role in the games Force Unleashed 2, Empire at War, Forces of Corruption, and Rebel Assault 2. So that's it for Stygium crystals. If you want to connect with us, help support the channel, or get your own copies of the reference material used to make this video, be sure to check out the links in the description. Special shout out to our supporters over on Patreon. But most important of all, remember, no problem's too big for an Imperial superweapon. And the Force will be with you. Always.